This lecture will cover Chapter 8 from the Campbell Biology textbook on photosynthesis. Photosynthesis being a major component, along with cellular respiration, of the carbon cycle, as we can see here. So in the carbon cycle, organisms like you and I respire, but don't forget plants respire as well, burning glucose and other macromolecules, producing carbon dioxide, which plants and other green organisms can then take in through the process of photosynthesis. If a plant happens to die before its carbon is released back into the atmosphere, then its carbon may well indeed over time become fossil fuel, as we see in the image down here, which humans can then burn for energy purposes and release CO2 in the atmosphere as well. So this is something you'll learn more about in ecology and perhaps bio too, but two of the major components of this cycle are respiration and photosynthesis, so applications of these cellular processes at the ecological level. The organisms involved in this process include the plants, as we see here, as well as algae, and then single-celled eukaryotes. But it also includes bacteria, such as the example shown here. So several eukaryotes do this, plants, algae, and single-celled eukaryotes, but bacteria, some bacteria, are also photosynthetic, able to undergo this process. In this process, we're going to reduce CO2 into glucose, and we're going to oxidize water, forming oxygen gas. Remember, these reactions involve the transfer of electrons. If you gain electrons, you are said to be reduced. And if you lose electrons, you are oxidized. So keep that in mind when you see these reactions. If you're reduced, you tend to become more complicated. You have extra hydrogens attached to you as well as electrons. If you're oxidized, you tend to be torn apart. John Baptista von Helmont first described the process by which a tree in a pot got much heavier than he expected. So basically what happened was the tree got heavier, the soil did not get lighter, or it didn't get much lighter. He predicted that a tree planted in a pot would eat the soil and become heavy, but instead he found the soil barely lost any mass, but the tree got heavier. So he deduced that something from the air must be making the plant heavier. Joseph Priestley came to the conclusion that vegetation changes the quality of air, adds something to the air that allows candles to burn, for example. And Jan Ingenhouse came up with then an explanation, the molecular explanation to what was going on, that carbon dioxide was split, releasing oxygen gas. We now know this to be false. In fact, what is really happening here is H2O, oops, let's see here, H2O is being split to produce hydrogen ions and oxygen gas. But at the time, they thought it was CO2. These processes are driven by visible light, which ranges from about 380 to 750 nanometers. And plants, as we'll see, are going to mostly use this high energy purple blue light here and this lower energy red light to run photosynthesis. So if we look at the different pigments involved using a spectrophotometer, we can see that chlorophyll A, B, and carotenoids each have different lambda maxes. And in fact, they have several peaks where they absorb light energy in the purple, blue, and the red spectrum. If we average these all together in the action spectrum, this shows us which wavelengths photosynthesis uses to actually do photosynthesis. We can see that we have purplish, bluish light, and red light. We described, you may have heard in lecture, about Engelmann's experiment in which he used aerobic bacteria before the invention of the spectrophotometer and a prism and a piece of algae that was photosynthesizing to deduce the action spectrum of photosynthesis using the patterns of aggregation of these bacteria on the slide. So this process uses chlorophyll A and B, Very similar structure to hemoglobin, except chlorophyll has a magnesium at the core here, slightly different structure, and chlorophyll A and B have slightly different parts here attached to this carbon. It also has a long tail, as we can see at the bottom here, that allows chlorophyll to embed into a plasma membrane, or in the case of plants, in the thylakoid membrane. So chlorophyll A and B, interesting pigments that actually can have electrons get excited by the energy of the light energy that they absorb. And also carotenoids, which are orangish or red pigments that help the plant to absorb other wavelengths of light and also act to prevent oxidation during these reactions. So these cells that do photosynthesis are generally found in the leaves of plants. Here we have it labeled the mesophyll tissue. If we look at a mesophyll cell, we'll see that they're loaded with chloroplasts. And then we zoom in on the chloroplast to see that it's composed of three different membranes. We have an outer membrane, as we can see in the diagram, an outer membrane, and an inner membrane, just like most bacteria. And we have a thylakoid membrane inside. Oops. We have a thylakoid membrane inside that is, kind of wavy. I'll just draw it like this very crudely, but you can see a drawing here of the same thing in more detail. Thylakoid membrane is folded up into stacks called grana or granum, and each individual fold is known as a thylakoid. And the space inside is known as the thylakoid space. And the hollow, this area that looks hollow here is actually filled with liquid. This area that surrounds the thylakoid, that is known as the stroma. So one unique property of chlorophyll is that as it gains light energy, its electrons get excited. And those electrons that get excited can be used to do work, such as produce ATP. Of course, if you destroy a leaf and grind it up and do this in a lab, you can still excite electrons, but they will have nowhere to go. And as they lose their energy, some of it will shine back out as red light. And we should see that in lab later this semester. So overall, the major reactions here are the light reactions in the Calvin cycle. The light reaction is going to use light energy and water and NADP plus to generate oxygen gas, NADPH, which is an electron shuttle, similar to NADH in respiration. And we're going to produce ATP out of this process as well. ATP and NADPH go to the Calvin cycle, where CO2 is brought in and sugars will be produced. So the light reactions in the Calvin cycle are the major parts of this reaction. The light reactions take place in the thylakoid membrane, while the Calvin cycle takes place in the stroma of that chloroplast. So the light cycle uses these sort of almost like factories that we call photosystems, which are a collection of different enzymes and pigments. So we have here we can see clearly chlorophyll, and there would also be carotenoids in there. That chlorophyll, part of it is like an antenna, which we can call the light harvesting complex, as you see here. Gathers light energy up and transfers that energy from one molecule to the other, and eventually transfers it to this special pair of chlorophyll A molecules that we can call the reaction center. Those special chlorophyll A molecules get very excited by that energy, and their electrons get very excited, and they will actually lose electrons as they get very excited and get further and further from the nucleus of their atoms. Those electrons can be lost and go to an electron acceptor. They call it the primary electron acceptor here. Then they will go off from there to do other things. So there's two photosystems in a plant. All of them have these light harvesting complexes of chlorophyll and reaction centers, photosystem 1 and photosystem 2. So both of them consist of pigments, chlorophyll A and B, as well as carotenoids, and a reaction center. Electrons will be lost from the reaction center and go to the electron acceptor. So looking at this cartoon, we can see how this will work. Electrons will gain energy here at the photosystem. So photosystem 2 is first. Electrons excite the electron, they're lost, and they go to a primary electron acceptor. They then go down an electron transport chain, just like in respiration, producing ATP. Then, after the electrons have lost a lot of their energy, they will gain more energy thanks to photosystem 1. They'll go to another electron acceptor, and then they will be used to reduce NADP plus to NADPH. So this is happening, this image we're about to see is taking place basically, let me get my arrow to appear here. Basically, these reactions that we're going to look at are taking place here inside the thylakoid space. So here we have a folded piece of thylakoid membrane, we have the thylakoid space, and we have photosystem 2, photosystem 1, and the electron transport chain connecting the two together. Light energy comes in, the electrons gain energy, they go to an acceptor, they go down the transport chain. While they go down that chain, they're used to power hydrogen pumps, proton pumps, that are pumping hydrogen ions into the thylakoid space. So we have a high concentration of hydrogen inside the thylakoid space. Hydrogen can then diffuse out of the thylakoid space into the stroma, generating ATP. So ATP synthase is involved. Meanwhile, these electrons gain energy again in photosystem 1 and are used then to reduce NADP plus to NADPH. This NADPH can then deliver electrons to the Calvin cycle, and ATP can go to the Calvin cycle as well. So the diffusion of electrons is going to be used, the diffusion of hydrogen ions is going to be used to power ATP synthase, making ATP. This is known in the case of plants as photophosphorylation. So you can compare that to oxidative phosphorylation as well as substrate level phosphorylation that we saw in respiration. So once again, these photosystems are using light energy to excite electrons that go up to an acceptor, down a transport chain, generate ATP, those electrons gain energy again, and then produce NADPH. Now, one thing I want to mention is that photosystem 2 here lost its electrons. It really wants to replace those electrons. So photosystem 2 oxidizes water to get the electrons it needs to reduce itself. So photosystem 2 here is a very strong oxidizer. It steals water, electrons from water to make itself complete again, and then it loses those electrons again as soon as light energy hits them. But this is how we generate the oxygen we breathe. Plants break apart water to release oxygen gas, which is why we can live on planet Earth. So a fairly important process here. Now occasionally, what we'll see in a future slide here, occasionally electrons go from here back down the transport chain. I just want to point that out. This is known as cyclic electron flow, because the Calvin cycle needs more ATP than NADPH. So that's what this image is showing here, cyclic electron flow. If electrons flow straight through like we showed earlier, that is called linear electron flow. But cyclic flow allows a plant to make more more ATP than NADPH. So make sure you compare the flow of electrons, the flow of hydrogen ions powered by the flow of electrons in mitochondria and chloroplasts. So in mitochondria, hydrogen ions flow from the intermembrane space into the matrix, and in mitochondria, hydrogen ions are flowing from the thylakoid space into the stroma. But in either case, we're using that to generate ATP. And in both cases, those hydrogen ions got to where they are thanks to the electron transport chain powered by the energy of electrons. Okay, so the Calvin cycle is the next step of this process, and we're going to use 9 ATP, and 3 carbon dioxide molecules and 6 NADPHs, and that'll make one molecule of G3P, which is kind of like pyruvate. It's a 3 carbon molecule. So we're going to take carbon and we're going to fix carbon, which means to stick it to something else. So carbon will be fixed to a molecule called RuBP, and that'll be catalyzed by an enzyme called Rubisco. Then we're going to add electrons and energy, and we're going to convert that molecule into G3P, which is a simple sugar, a 3 carbon sugar. Then RuBP is going to be regenerated, and 5 of them are going to be converted back to RuBP, and the cycle will repeat. So these are the 3 major steps: carbon fixation, reduction, and regeneration of RuBP. So total, to make one glucose, you need 2 G3P. So to make one glucose molecule, you're going to need 18 ATPs and 12 NADPHs to make one sugar. And if you, of course, burn that glucose through respiration, you're going to get about 30 ATP out of it. So the plant makes out ahead through this process, thanks to the input of energy from the sun. So here is the Calvin cycle. We can see the first step is carbon fixation. Notice we have carbon dioxide up here coming into the plant. We have an enzyme called Rubisco in action here. Rubisco sticks RuBP, which is ribulose biphosphate, sticks it to carbon dioxide, forming this molecule here that we're not going to memorize, but we make a molecule that then has electrons and energy added thanks to ATP, so we're using ATP as basically a activation energy source. And we're going to add electrons in, and we're going to end up making G3P, glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, which is a sugar. We make 6 of these. One of them exits the Calvin cycle to become one half of a glucose, right? The other 5 have to have ATP added again and then an enzyme will catalyze a reaction, reforming RuBP, which goes on into the next cycle of the Calvin cycle. So this is a cyclic reaction, whereas some of the products are also the reactants in the next stage of the reaction. So it just goes round and round and round. Every time this cycle goes around, one half of a glucose is made in the form of G3P. And we're going to burn ATP to do this. We're going to add electrons to do this. Those electrons and that ATP come from the light reactions. So, phase 1, carbon fixation. You glue CO2, which is, you know, most of it's carbon basically. You glue CO2 to RuBP. Then you're going to add electrons, so you reduce it. Then you're going to get some sugar out of that, but you're also going to regenerate your CO2 acceptor, which is RuBP, using some ATP. You burn some more ATP, reforming RuBP so that the cycle can continue. One thing I want to point out is that enzyme Rubisco, let's go back up here, Rubisco catalyzes the reaction, allowing RuBP to stick to carbon dioxide. But if there's not enough carbon dioxide around, it does something that is not good for the plant. It can also stick oxygen to RuBP, which is not useful for the plant. This is called photophosphorylation. So generally what it does is carboxylation, which means it sticks CO2 to RuBP. So it fixes CO2. That's what happens under normal conditions when there's enough carbon dioxide around. But if there's not enough carbon dioxide around, it will switch and the active site will start reacting with oxygen. So Rubisco's active site will start sticking oxygen to RuBP. And this produces a product that the plant can't use, and the plant actually has to burn extra ATP to fix. And this is a negative energy loss for the plant. So it's a negative condition. The plant will lose energy thanks to photorespiration. So bear in mind, carbon dioxide and oxygen both compete for the active site for RuBP. But RuBP favors carbon dioxide. See, RuBP evolved before there was much oxygen on the planet. So this wasn't a problem until there was a lot of oxygen present on the planet Earth. So how do plants fight this issue? Well, generally, they're okay. There's enough CO2 around that plants are okay. They're happy. But what plants can do to fight this if it is a problem, especially in hot environments. You see, in hot environments, plants have to close the pores in their leaves to prevent from dehydrating. But this also means they can't get fresh CO2 into the leaf. So the plants are making oxygen thanks to photosynthesis, but it can't get out of the leaf because the pores are closed, and CO2 can't get into the leaf because the pores are closed. So this leads to photorespiration. Hot, dry environments cause the plant to undergo photorespiration, basically. They have to prevent dehydration. So what you can do is you can separate your Calvin cycle from your light reactions, so your O2 is being generated far away from Rubisco. Or you can bring CO2 in at night and store it and release it during the day, so even if it is hot and dry and your pores are closed, you still have plenty of CO2 around, so oxygen does not compete for the active site. So there are two ways to do this. First of all, we call these C4 plants because one of the first carbon molecules produced is a 4-carbon compound in C4 plants. So certain plants do this using C4 metabolism. And in C4 metabolism, you separate the Calvin cycle from the light reactions into separate cells. So having a look here, what you do is your light reactions are in your normal plant mesophyll cells. And your C4 reactions are going to take place in the cells that surround your veins. We call these bundle sheath cells. Okay? So over here is mesophyll. In the mesophyll, you have CO2 coming in, you have your light reactions happening. But what your cells will do is they will take carbon dioxide, burn a little bit of ATP, but not as much as it would cost to undergo photorespiration, burn a little bit of ATP to convert carbon into malate, which is a 4-carbon compound that the plant can then pump into the bundle sheath cell. That's why it's called C4 anatomy. The carbon compound here has 4 carbons in it. It pumps it into a separate cell, so it pumps it from over here to over here. Then CO2 is released again and the Calvin cycle takes place over here. So the cells over here are making oxygen, but the cells over here are using carbon dioxide. So this allows the plant to try to separate the two processes to avoid photorespiration. Because most of the O2 that's being produced by the plant is over here, while CO2 is being used over here. That helps the plant to avoid accidentally sticking oxygen to its RUBP. So a simpler way to see that here, we can see here we have mesophyll cell, bundle sheath cell, CO2 comes in, it's converted to a form that can be transported, an organic acid, it's transferred to the bundle sheath cell, and that's where the Calvin cycle takes place. So we separate the light reactions from the Calvin cycle in space. The other way to do this is called CAM photosynthesis. It stands for crassulean acid metabolism, but you don't have to know that. But just have a look at how this works. You should be familiar with CAM photosynthesis. In CAM photosynthesis, carbon dioxide is brought in at night when the plant will not dehydrate very easily. So it can open the pores in its leaf. The stomata is the proper term here. It opens its stomata, allows carbon dioxide in, and then it stores that carbon dioxide as an acid. And it stores it perhaps in its central vacuole, but it stores it somewhere in the cell. And then during the daytime, when CO2 is needed, even if the pores are shut, the stomata are closed, and oxygen is building up in the leaf, what the plant does, it converts that organic acid back to carbon dioxide. So there's always plenty of CO2 around inside that mesophyll cell, and you never have photorespiration take place. So the two ways to do this, to fight photorespiration: one, separate your light reactions and your Calvin cycle into different cells, or two, bring in CO2 at night and release it during the day. That will help to prevent this negative process known as photorespiration. So overall, we've seen this process. Light reactions are driven by light energy. We split water to release oxygen gas. We produce ATP and NADPH, which go to the Calvin cycle. CO2 is brought in. We generate sugars, glucose, and possibly even sucrose. And then the products coming out of the Calvin cycle can be rejuvenated again by the light reactions. NAD plus, ADP can go over here, become ATP and NADP plus again. So this cycle is what keeps us heterotrophs alive. The autotrophs provide us with food to eat and oxygen to breathe. We in turn provide plants with carbon dioxide that they can then glue back together again into large macromolecules such as glucose and starch.